Good morning.
Good morning.
How do you follow that? That was incredible. Thank you so much. Happy Father's Day to you who are fathers today. We hope you have a wonderful and blessed day. This is a day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in
it. And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us worship.
All who are able and willing, please stand for our call to worship. This is based on the Gospel of Mark. When dangers invade our sense of safety and we wonder if our Redeemer cares, we hear the invitation.
Be at peace, be calm.
When we face job loss and financial downturns, and our sense of security is shaken, we hear the invitation.
Be at peace, be calm.
When our congregations experience distress, conflict, and loss of significant leadership, we hear the invitation.
Be at peace, be calm.
When controversial issues and rigidity of spirit threaten to tear at the very fabric of the faith community, we hear again the invitation.
Be at peace, be calm.
When our lives feel chaotic and desolate because of illness or sorrow, we hear the invitation.
Be at peace, be calm.
As we continue our worship with our opening hymn, Eternal Father, Strong to Save, which is also known as the Navy hymn. So, Happy Father's Day to all those Navy veterans. They mounted up to heaven. They went down to the depths. Their courage Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. Then they were glad because they had quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven. Let them thank the Lord for their for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind. Let them extol him in the congregation of the people, and praise him in the assembly of the elders from the north and from the south. This ends our first reading. Now we will enjoy our puppets.
Sunday and Wednesday. My dad, well, as wonderful as he is,
to do some special prayers today that is printed in your bulletin. And before we do that, we're going to sing just one verse in preparation of the hymn, Dear Lord and Father of the World. For men, though without children of their own, acted like a father and have nurtured and cared for us.
Holy God, hear this prayer for our father figures.
For stepfathers, who assume that role with love and joy, who have loved the children of another as their own and created a new family.
Holy God, hear this prayer.
For adopted fathers who have claimed the orphan and loved the once unwanted as a precious gift from God.
Holy God, hear this prayer for adopted fathers.
For fathers who have been unable to be a source of strength, who have not responded to the needs of their children, and have not sustained their families.
Holy God, have mercy on us.
For fathers who struggle with temptation, with violence and addiction, for those who do harm, and for those whom they have harmed,
Holy God, have mercy on the fathers that struggle.
For new fathers, full of hope, for long-time fathers, full of wisdom, for the fathers yet to be, for fathers soon to be, for those who have shaped our lives without claim of family or kinship, for those who have taught us, guided us, shaped us, and molded us into servants of Christ our Lord. God, our Father, in your wisdom and love you made all things. Bless these men, that they may be strengthened as Christian fathers. Let the example of their faith and love shine forth. Grant that we, their sons and daughters, may honor them always with a spirit of profound respect. Grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. To us from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, 35 through 41. It is printed in your bulletin, so you may read along with me if you like. On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm rose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" May God add understanding to our hearing of the word this morning. Let us begin in prayer. We thank you, Lord, for your words of peace that live on in your church. Give us the insight and courage to be your followers in heart, mind, and deed. And now, God, grant the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts may always be acceptable in thy sight, O our Lord, our Redeemer, and our friend. This is the sermon that nearly did not happen, because, foolishly, I agreed to let Sunday cut off our Wi-Fi on Thursday. And in typing my sermon, it told me, the Word program that I use, that it could not save my sermon because I had no connectivity. I knew I was going to have to print my sermon here, but I didn't know that I may not be able to say the sermon I wrote at home. So on a way out of prayer, Bryant drove me here, and I pressed the button, and lo and behold, it was a miracle, there it was. So I am saved by technology once again. You know, the lesson for today in the gospel is reminiscent to me of the story of Jonah, where a storm threatens to overcome the boat in which Jonah is trying to escape God's call to prophesy to Jonah's enemies. Do you remember that story? He's running away. He thinks that the sea can save him from God. Jonah is thrown overboard to appease what the sailors think is an angry divine force, where he is swallowed by a great fish, not a whale, a great fish that God is supposedly sent to preserve him from drowning. Remember, he lives in the great fish for how long? 3 days, until he is spewed upon the shores of Nineveh. Texas may not have first-hand knowledge about life-threatening storms at sea, but you do have your share, more than your share, of life-threatening storms on land. And some of it comes with floodwaters, right? When the sea and the sky rages, it seems appropriate to be afraid. You know, when they send out those tornado warnings, I take cover, even in Illinois. And I have to tell you that when the derecho came in Illinois in 2009, is that right, Ron?
Yeah.
2009, I was at home alone. Trees were starting to hit our roof, crash bang, and I thought I was going to die. So I took refuge in the bathroom, the only room downstairs that has no windows. Then I realized, as I sat there, that right above my head was another bathroom. And that I was going to be found, my corpse was going to be found, with a toilet on top of it. And I couldn't stand the indignity of that, so I went back in the living room and cowered and waited to die. It seems appropriate to be afraid, so we identify with the disciples who observe an oblivious sleeping Jesus asking, "Teacher, do you not care? We are perishing." When storms threaten and innocent lives are at risk, people often wonder why a loving, all-powerful God does not seem to care we are perishing. It is the crucible to ask and to find answers. Why do bad things happen to good people? Is it because they do not have enough faith? Or because God is testing our faith? Or maybe God is angry and punishing us for some societal sin. Years ago, when we were living in Oklahoma, Tulsa was being threatened by another hurricane. They had a lot of them there. That had already ripped through Oklahoma City. Ron Graves, my spouse, was working at the Ford Glass plant nearby Broken Arrow. And if you don't understand what glass plants do, they keep shards of glass in mountains of shard glass. And they have a furnace that burns really, really hot. So they are very vulnerable to storms. The workers were to be taken by bus to safety in an underground bunker. These are people well acquainted with the life-threatening reality of storms. Realizing the seriousness of the situation, Ron called home to say goodbye. But it was our teenage daughter who answered the phone. I then had two storms to weather. The threat of a tornado in nearby Prior, and the hysterics of a teenager who thought she was going to lose her father. Fortunately for our family, the tornado lifted at the Arkansas River. That's how you say it in Oklahoma, not the Arkansas River, but the Arkansas River, and did not come back down. The Oklahoma skies are as dramatic as their open ranges, where one is afforded an uninterrupted view of a very expansive sky. Residents were alarmed by the Grace family's fascination with thunderstorms because when the more educated Oklahomans were taking cover, we were outside under the front porch watching the clouds boil and the lightning strike, clueless that this was not the time for gawking. Our calm wasn't due to our faith, I'm sorry to say, but to our inexperience. In ancient times, the threat of stormy seas was attributed to the forces of chaos or even evil. These overwhelming events seemed all powerful, and yet Jesus, as a fellow Galilean, a peasant, spoke and calmed the life-threatening sea. The astounded disciples asked, "Who is this then, that even the wind and sea obey him?" They don't get it. They've been living with Jesus, watching him perform miracles, and they still don't get it. That should give you hope. The disciples whom we were taught to attribute the witness of Christianity, the saints of the church, don't get it. You feel better now? They do not yet understand who Jesus is. And maybe that inability to fully grasp the import of Jesus is responsible for their abandonment of their teacher at his arrest, trial, and crucifixion. Then again, the demonic wrath of Roman crucifixion was a threatening storm informed people would want to avoid. Terror was and is an effective tool to control the masses until we've had enough of living in fear. Have you had enough of living in fear? I've had enough. Biblical scholars ask, who was the target audience to whom the writer of Scripture is writing? you might be surprised to learn that Mark did not write the gospel for you. He had an attendant audience. And scholars ask, what is that reality, that worldview to whom Mark is writing? How would they have heard this word? We can't know with certainty because Mark didn't date his gospel, written on AD 63. But we have a pretty good idea about the window in which it was written. The Gospel of Mark, biblical scholars suppose, would have been the earliest of the four Gospels. Likely, it was written before the Roman invasion of Jerusalem, about 35 years after the first Easter. This is a time of great fear for the church. Paul was either in Roman prison or dead. Peter was most likely also executed by this time. The life-threatening storm of Roman retribution was a reality for Jews and followers of Jesus, who would be Jews or Gentiles. It was a time to be afraid. Be very afraid. But into that chaos comes a spoken word from Jesus. Peace, be still. And after the wind and sea have calmed, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? Is Mark's Jesus speaking just to those disciples in the story, in the boat upon the sea, or is he speaking also to the body of Christ, who is called to be the prophetic teacher in the world? What does it mean to have faith in the midst of the storm, when the storms of life threaten? I'm not sure I know all the answers, but if you would permit me to ponder with you, I think I might stumble on a few possibilities. Faith in Jesus might mean, Ron, is that your phone?
Yeah.
I had that happen in the pulpit once while I was preaching. So believe me, I know what that means. But you have grace here, honey. God love you. It's okay. Faith in Jesus might mean we believe with the Apostle Paul that nothing, I mean nothing, can separate us from the love we know in Christ Jesus. No power, especially the gates of hell, can prevail against the power of Jesus to calm the storms threatening to overwhelm us. Not even our inability to have faith will determine or deter the power of God to act. The disciples did not have enough faith, but Jesus acted to calm the wind and the sea despite his followers' inability to believe. You feel better yet? It's not up to you, my friends. God has God's own agency. I have faith in God's agency. When I entered Phillips Theological, I'm on medication, can you tell? When I entered Phillips Theological Seminary in 1993, I was surprised to find many of my classmates were Methodists who had been attending Oral Roberts Seminary. Now, in the Northwest, where I'm from, Methodists are known as progressive social activists, not Oral Roberts material. I learned that Oral Roberts had once been aligned with the Methodists, but no longer. more Pentecostal Methodists, seminarians, a transfer of schools would be necessary to be acceptable Methodist ordained ministers. Surprise! Oh gosh, I wish you could have been there with me to see the weeping and gnashing of teeth. So it was I found myself working with Pentecostals on a class project. When Ron was seeking employment, he didn't have a job. It was kind of scary. Of course, when my fellow students learned at Mark High, they wanted to pray over the issue, asking God to get Ron a job. I was so uncomfortable. But my mother raised me to be gracious and keep my mouth shut when it was appropriate. So I submitted myself to their ministrations. A week later, Ron got a job. I was more than reluctant to share this with my classmates, who took great pride in their power of prayer. I don't believe God has to be persuaded to show loving kindness by our ability to believe any more than a loving parent must be persuaded to seek the welfare of their children through their petitions. I never had to beg my father to do good things for me, or to want good things for me. We want our children to be happy and desire them to thrive because that is the nature of love, right? If God is love, then it's God's nature to want what is best for us. But faith in Jesus might mean we can face the storms that come with confidence that words still have power to calm. First, our own stormy thoughts within, as well as those that threaten us from without. Maybe offering greetings like, "Peace be with you," really has currency. Yeah? In her sermon at the National Cathedral in 2018, Texan Brene Brown says she wants to worship with strangers, offering and receiving blessings of peace to people she might want to punch in the face on Monday through Saturday. But on Sunday, when Dr. Brown worships, she is especially blessed, she says, by passing the peace with those folk with whom she differs and receiving the peace from them. I think that's very interesting and very compelling. Now, I can't preach on Father's Day without talking about my father. This is the first Father's Day that I will have, along with Jim Carter's family, without. My father was the pillar of calm. Yeah? I think Jim was probably like that sometimes too, not always. We rarely saw him lose his temper or his control. I have this vivid memory of an anxious but beloved church saint whose name was Odess Emerson. A name like Odess Emerson might spell trouble, I don't know. But I've never run into another like her. She was one of my particular personal saints. But she would follow on the heels of my dad, usually on a Sunday morning, with a litany of complaints of church members who were abusing, she thought, church property. She was so concerned about the abuse of church property that she kept all the churches glassware, stemware, and linens at her house. You had to check it out, Colonel Dex. And woe betide you if you didn't return it in the shape that she released it to you. Dad, who was always that person you went to in the midst of a storm, would calmly answer Odessa's threats, what she was going to do with Odessa. You don't want to do that. And she just kept on walking. No one else could manage Odessa's anxiety, not even her husband, like my father. My stint in Oklahoma offered me a soul sister, now a colleague in the disciple ministry, whose father was a farmer, a father, a church presence extraordinaire. He was also a pillar of calm and strength in the midst of life's storms on whom his family and his preacher depended. He was known for saying to anxious folk, "Things have a way of working out." Yeah. On his deathbed, he said to me, his pastor in training, "I love you. I love you." I loved his hospital bed more humble. That was a long time ago, and I'm still getting emotional. More humble, but less anxious. He had calmed my inward chaos with his words. Faith in Jesus might mean we refuse to allow the storms of life to control us. In my vocation, I am trusted and privileged to hear many stories of crisis, storms that people somehow survive. Once in a while, I hear folks say that they are grateful for the lessons the storm taught them, because as they survive these challenges they neither asked for nor anticipated, they grew stronger, more resilient, more compassionate. I'm encouraged by such stories of survival. They have much to teach us, but unfortunately, because there is often shame attached to these human stories, they are not common knowledge. Shame happens, my friends, when we allow the storms that happen to us control us and drive us into the shadows of secrecy, where shame, like mushrooms, grow in the dark. When I was a ministerial intern at First Christian Church in Corvallis, Oregon, I heard a story from a congregational member who told me when our pastor admitted he was ashamed, for he did not, as his father had, have it all together yet. He was 44 and he didn't have it all together yet. And this woman said, it gave her permission, his confession of not having it all together, gave her permission to admit her own frustration and shame. That day, I learned that failure, shame, and personal struggles may serve ministry in more powerful ways than my strengths. My faith would be in the efficacy of God, not in my abilities to be God-like. Besides, I'm more like my earthly grandmother and my mother, who never met a stranger, embarrassed us frequently, and always had something to say. My irreverent, rebellious, earthy spirit is part of my DNA. So friends, when you feel safe to do so, put on the calm of Christ and let yourself be vulnerable to your brothers and sisters of faith. Tell them stories. Tell them stories of the storms you passed through with God's grace, praying that it will build up another who is struggling with something similar. Shame isolates us. The stories of human vulnerabilities can unite and even encourage us on our journey. Amen. Bigger.